Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.
Hi, good evening. My name is Stephanie Towles, and welcome to this edition of Workers in Berks, brought to you each month by Berks Labor Council. We are talking today about what it means to be part of a labor union. And the reason why we're talking about it, there's a couple reasons why this topic is really important right now. The first being that we just celebrated Labor Day. Unlike years past where we would all gather and have the day off and have a big Labor Day parade, we've been unable to do that, and that didn't happen this year. And so a lot of people knew it was a day off. A lot of people knew stores were having sales, but a lot of people didn't take much time to think about what is Labor Day and why do we even have it as a day to celebrate. The other thing is that a lot of younger people are being exposed to unions for the first time and in new ways, and are learning some things about unions and how unions operate that may not that they may not have thought about before. So as we move into November, you may have heard that there's going to be an election and the unions are talking about it. But before I get into talking about why the unions are so concerned about the election, I'd like to introduce my guest. My guest is a very close friend and a very amazing union leader who is a terrific person for explaining and advocating on behalf of working people and working families. And he also happens to be a teacher, and he advocates on behalf of the teachers that he serves as well. So my guest is Mr. Brian Sanguinito. Welcome, Brian.
Thank you for having me.
I'm very glad to have you here tonight. And as we go into this, I would like to just kind of start with the fact that I understand that you are part of the union family from before you were old enough to actually have a union job yourself. So I just want you to tell me a little bit about your background with unions before you were part of the workforce.
Sure. Well, I grew up, my dad was a factory worker, and I knew what laid off and on strike meant before I could actually spell my last name. And I didn't realize we were poor because my parents never let me know we were poor, but growing up, we would pour the coins that we collected in those bottles, we would pour them out and we would count them. And I always thought it was a fun experience. And I thought it was fun when I was wearing my cousin's clothes. I didn't realize that we got hand-me-downs because we really couldn't afford new clothing. But somebody said, you can't spell union Sanguinito without unionist, and it's real. Because honestly, it's in my blood. Working people have always done the majority of what's made this country great, and yet we've gotten the minority of the benefits from it. So the only thing that makes the playing field even is the union. So I was really happy when I became a teacher back in 1997. One of the first things I did was I joined the union, and I've been going strong ever since. 2002 is when I really started getting involved. Actually, I went to a representative assembly at the national level in Dallas, Texas, and I fell in love with the fact that every single person had a voice. It didn't matter if you were a teacher for 40 years or for 4 months. Every single person in that union mattered equally, and we all had ideas on how to make our profession better and in turn how to make society better. And so unionism is in my blood. I love it, and I'll love it until the day I die.
I like that in your family, where you have two generations of union people, you've got two very different work classes. You said your dad worked in a factory, you're a teacher, which is considered more like a white collar career. A lot of times when people think about unions, people think about people that wear hard hats, construction sites. People don't realize that unions represent not only teachers, but there are union associations that represent nurses and our firefighters and professionals, social workers, and right, and all different types of professions. And I think that it's important to help people make that connection Because oftentimes when you see something in the media about unions, or when you see unions depicted in a movie or on a TV show, it's usually the blue collar construction worker. It's usually someone in one of the trade unions.
Right. And a lot of times when people try to attack unions, they're attacking union members. When they attack union bosses, they're attacking me. They're attacking you. I mean, I'm a union boss, I guess, because I'm a regional president of a union, but, you know, we still have to live paycheck to paycheck, and we don't have a lot of political power like a lot of people who oppose unions want to make you think. But the real reason why they're against us is because they have money, but we have numbers, and they don't want that even playing field. That's why this election is so important coming up. You said we have an election coming up, but this is actually the most important election in my 45 years that I can possibly remember. There have been so many attacks on weakening our unions, starting with the Janus decision, which allows freeloaders now to be able to reap the benefits of unionism without paying their fair share. And all we want as a union is for people to pay their fair share and do what is right. And, you know, I was thinking about this actually this morning. This whole division between factions in our country didn't start with the current president. It started back when the Congress under President Obama refused to advise and consent, as was their constitutional duty, with his Supreme Court nominee. And it's just exacerbated the situation. The past 4 years have exacerbated that rift between us. But I want to urge people, I don't really care in your union, if you're a Republican, a Democrat, or an independent, we have to vote our jobs, because there are no legislators out there who care more about our jobs than their jobs. Right? So they can talk a good talk, but at the end of the day, they care about getting reelected. So we need to make sure that we raise our voices. You see a sign behind me, our union, the Eastern Region of PSEA. We had a kickoff the other week, and we were talking about letting your voice be heard. And it's really important that this election, especially, we organize, we mobilize, we talk about why this election matters so much, that we vote for people who care about working people, not people who talk about it and then give tax breaks to their corporate wealthy benefactors, but people who are actually on the ground like we are, people who actually respect what we do.
And I'm going to give you a chance. You mentioned you referred to your poster, you mentioned PSEA. I'm going to give you a chance to spell that out. Tell everyone which union it is you're affiliated with.
Sure. So I'm the Eastern Region President of the Pennsylvania State Education Association. We represent 180,000 public school educators and education support professionals throughout this Commonwealth. And we are the largest labor union in this state.
All right. So prior to being the president of Eastern Region, you held another prominent position.
Well, yes. Actually, we're part of the largest labor union in the entire nation. We might not be the largest in this state, but we are one of the largest in the state. But I was actually president of one of the very largest local associations in the state, and that was the Reading Education Association. Where we represented at one point 1,300 teachers until 2011, when Governor Corbett made all those budget cuts and we had furloughs. But I was proud to be the Reading Education Association president back then, and to fight for our members to make sure that we had better working conditions for our members and better learning conditions for our students, that we had clear, concise, and consistent expectations of our members, and making sure that our students had the resources they needed to succeed.
So let me ask you a question about that, because you said at one point 1,300 members. You've got to have people in there from all different political persuasions, from every, you know, running the gamut of the spectrum politically, politic-wise. So when you're representing such a, how do you represent such a broad group? I mean, how can you let people with such various different ideas, backgrounds, values, family, personal history. How is it that you can talk to them about politics? Because frankly, politics is a really tough subject to talk about now more than ever. But even, you know, even 20 years ago, you know, it was one of those things where you didn't really want to go there because you don't want to delve too deeply into someone's personal private business, you know. But as a union leader, you're forced to kind of have that conversation. How does that happen?
Well, Steph, I honestly believe that if we don't define ourselves, we allow our opponents to define us. And there, in our union, there's no R or D. There's only PE. That's public education. As long as politicians are involved in education, educators must be involved in politics. This past year has taught us that every single decision that affects our jobs, our livelihoods, and our schools is a political decision made by other people. But the ultimate decision, who those other people are, that needs to be made by us. So we need to clearly define what our values and our beliefs are, and then consistently preach those values and beliefs when we make the decisions of who we want to support. And what we do is we make recommendations. We have a very, very drawn out process of how we make recommendations. And we've recommended Republicans in the past. We've recommended Democrats in the past. We've recommended independents. It just matters that those people support our jobs and our students. You have plenty of people out there who want to privatize education and turn it into a billion-dollar corporation on the backs of our students and not give anybody any rights, any workplace rights. And we need to make sure that we fight against that. And the only way to do that, from the local school board level to your state legislator level to the federal level, is to make sure that your voice is heard at the ballot box.
And you know, as you talked about that effort for privatization, it made me think of another big public entity that is a union-based organization that there's a lot of stress on right now around privatization. And that's the Postal Service. The post office is not a business designed to make a profit. The post office is designed to give a service to American citizens. And so when you talk about privatization, you're talking about basically possibly turning over that institution that so many Americans rely on to be affordable and to be consistent. People that require medicine that comes in the mail, people waiting for their paycheck. You're turning that over to a private entity, and they could choose to do whatever with it. You know what I mean? And so it's not just when we talk about the union and the teachers, it's also and public education workers, it's also the union in every different industry. One of the things that United Labor Council held special workshops on was it wasn't supposed to happen to me. NAFTA, the NAFTA agreement, which affected so many of the jobs with the trades and so many blue collar workers and so many jobs going overseas. When the workers whose jobs were put on the line and were threatened, those workers needed to really make their voices heard with the politicians. And they were really frustrated and upset when they felt that that didn't happen. So here we are in another election cycle, another opportunity. And so how do you decide when you're a leader of the union, how do you decide which candidate you're going to ask your members to support? How do you decide which races to get involved in and which races to stay out of?
Well, you know, Steph, if the only time people think about their union is when they have a problem, then we have a problem. We need to constantly be a presence, a positive presence in our members' lives. We need to talk about what matters to them. We need to talk about the progress that's happening, not only at the state level, but the federal level. And we need to let them know. We need to educate them about what's happening. That way, when we finally get to a time where we have to make a choice for an election, the members already have buy-in. They know who's supporting them. They know who's passing the bills that are gonna help them, and they know who's passing the bills that are gonna hurt them. They know the difference between payroll tax, losing a payroll tax being a gift to people versus trying to destroy Social Security. I mean, they know the difference because we, as their union leaders, let them know what's happening. So, like I said, we have a process in place. It's our Political Action Committee for Education, where we send questionnaires to every candidate who's running for any office, and they can decide whether or not to seek our endorsement. And it's an interview process where a team gets together and then makes an ultimate decision, and it keeps going up the ladder until an endorsement is made. But that is a member-driven decision, and it's our job as the people who represent those members to stay on top of what's happening. None of these things that are happening right now are just happening in a vacuum or overnight. These are things that have been constantly building. And there are politicians who try to distract you from what's really going on. They try to maybe present a red herring when we should really be focused on what's happening to the attacks against working class people. They've been happening for 30 or 40 years now, but they're really, really bad lately. And that's why we need a change, especially at the federal level, if we want to see anything positive happen.
And I understand that you're talking about the way that you go about endorsing local candidates here in the Lehigh Valley, Reading, Berks area, but also at the national level, the national labor unions are sending out surveys to the candidates who are running at the highest level nationally. And nothing speaks stronger to me and my interest than to know that we sent surveys out to all of the candidates. And if there are some candidates who don't even take the time to complete the survey, that tells me a lot about what that person thinks about my profession, my opinion, and my values, and the things, and whether or not that person's really going to support me and represent me if they're elected to that position.
Well, everybody who's watching this needs to ask themselves a simple question. Does your lawmaker or your politician of choice support the job that you do? And if the answer is no, then why would you support that lawmaker? It's very, very simple. What goes around comes around. We have the power, but we only get that power during election day. None of the other times do we have the power. We can send people to talk, we can send people to advocate, but while they have power all the time, we only have power on election day. So that is why it is so utterly important that we make sure our voices are heard, because if we get it wrong again, it's not only that we cannot afford to be wrong, we might not be able to survive it if we get it wrong this time.
One of the things that, people see every time you turn on TV right now, you see campaign ads for the election that's coming up. And when you talked about people need to think about who supports my job, who supports the work that I do, I don't want people to mistake that for who has a cute campaign slogan or who said something nice sitting in front of a group of people dressed like I dress when I go to work.
Nope. The proof is in the pudding.
The unions all have a history of voting records that they can tell you where people stood on different issues. If you're not sure about a candidate, if you think, well, I think this candidate's great, contact your local union and ask them, how did that politician vote on the issues that were our top priorities last year?
Where did they stand? Or who do they put in office to oversee those departments? When you have somebody who hates the Environmental Protection Agency placed in charge of the Environmental Protection Agency, and you have somebody who hates the post office in charge of the post office, and you have somebody who hates public education in charge of public education, that sends a loud and clear message. It doesn't matter what the words are, it matters what the actions are. And that's why we have to be very astute and very aware when we make this decision. This is a no-brainer. Listen, if you're confused about this election as a union member, there's no way we can ever convince you, because there have been so many attacks against our unions. And again, there are a lot of nice things said about working people, but when you see people being laid off and who are saying, I'll never vote that way again, I was hoodwinked, I was lied to, I know something about living in a family that's laid off, and it's a horrible situation. And just talk to one of those people who regrets their vote back in 2016 and listen very closely, and you'll understand that we need to change this year.
One of the things that that Berks Labor Council is trying to do is we're trying to set up some information debate types of programs where we will be on BCTV with some candidates who are running for some of the local offices. And we've done this before in the past. And it gives a chance to ask the candidates the exact same question and get their real-time live answer at the exact same time. And it gives people an opportunity to be able to kind of weigh the differences. And so that's something that I hope our viewers will pay attention to. We hope to have something like that happening the end of October before the election. And so as we open our mail and get, I'm getting stuff in the mail every single day. I'm seeing ads on TV, commercials, every single day. I'm hearing them on the radio. And the new one is I'm getting text messages all the time asking, did I remember to register to vote? Did I make sure that I sent in for a mail-in ballot? Do I know which candidates my union is supporting? And it feels like overkill. It feels like too much. But then every once in a while, I'll have a conversation with a colleague who hasn't been paying attention,
right,
and says, and is misinformed and says, well, I think that candidate is going to be good for us. And then I have to go back and say, no. Did you read your mail?
Right.
Go back and look at those emails. But all of that information that's being put out from the unions, it's being put out for a very important reason. And, you know, we keep talking about unions. This program is called Workers in Berks. Certainly the information we give you on this program, we wanted to support anyone who is part of a working family, but we also want to remind people of the key element. Unions were the backbone of this community. And as union membership has drifted down, it has done so due to the corporations. You know, a lot of manufacturing left, but a lot of corporations choose not to have their workers unionized. And as we see all of the new construction that's coming, we have the new Amazon plant that's getting ready to come up. So we're going to actually have two Amazon plants in Berks County. Those workers are not unionized. And when we look at, we talked a lot about essential workers. When we looked at the people who continued to make sure we had food on our table during this pandemic, who made sure that things got shipped to where they needed to be, those people are going to start asking for better wages, more support, better benefits. And the way that they're going to be able to get those things is through a union. So if you work somewhere that doesn't have a union and you hear us talking union, 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 please understand, it's not that I've got a union and I want to talk about my union. It's that I think everyone should have a union. And if you don't understand what unions do, you may not realize what you're missing.
And to that point, you know, a lot of people don't, from what I hear, some people say, well, why does your union give you that benefit and this benefit? And my question is, why don't you have a union that gives you those benefits? Because not a single benefit that any union worker has ever been given to them out of the goodness of their employer's heart. People have sweat, they've shed tears, they've shed blood, people have died in the labor struggle. And now that we're away from that, think about the fact that the weekend wouldn't exist, child labor would still be around, many, many horrible standards that weren't, the conditions that were only taken care of because of unions existing. And we tend to forget, we have a short memory as a society about how bad things used to be. Once the union goes, if the union goes, it's going to be nearly impossible to get it back, especially in this culture. So we should all be fighting to have strong unions and to keep strong unions. And if we don't have them at our jobs, we should be talking to other people about the fact that we want to be able to negotiate our salaries. We want to be able to negotiate our health care and our benefits. These are things that are really important, especially in 2020. And these are things that your union will be able to help you get.
And let's not forget pension.
And pensions.
We, We work very hard all our lives. We want to know that when the time comes, we will be able to retire with grace.
And that's something, you know, pensions are deferred compensation. That's all it is. I'm not getting extra money at the end. I'm deciding to take less money now so that when I retire, I can have a better quality of life. That's what it is. And they shouldn't be able to take those away.
Mm-hmm. Well, Brian, I appreciate you educating us and keeping us well informed, not only here tonight, but in all the other different things that you do in our community. We are very glad to have you here. And I hope that you and your family stay safe and that I will be talking to you again soon.
Thank you, my friend. God bless you guys. God bless our unions. God bless our workers. Thank you for everything you do. And if you're still on the fence, please vote for a change November 3rd. We need a new direction in this country so that we can strengthen workers, we can strengthen unions, and we can get back to doing the business of America.
Okay. Thank you for joining us for this episode of Workers in Berks. Please join us again here next month at the same time, and we will be talking with another guest about another topic of interest to those of you who want to support working families. Thank you. Have a pleasant evening.
Workers in Berks is supported by Southeastern PA Area Labor Federation.